Thanks to CuriosityStream for supporting my channel. Check out the extended version of my videos when you sign up for CuriosityStream and Nebula using the link in the description. Hey guys, it's Jordan, and welcome back to my channel. Today I'm going to tell you four things that I wish I knew before I started my PhD. As you can see, this is going to be a little bit more of a casual video because I'm actually in the process of taking my qualifying exams for my PhD. And if you want to hear more about that, you should check out my vlog channel. But I thought that it would be interesting to give you guys some insights into some of the stuff that I've learned since starting my PhD that I definitely would have liked to know before I got here. As always, if you're new here, consider subscribing, and you can follow my PhD life on TikTok, Twitter, Instagram, and now the new vlog channel, so head over there. So if you're new to my channel, for a little bit of context, I'm a PhD student in the Medical Engineering and Medical Physics program that's jointly run by Harvard and MIT. My program does rotations, so I didn't have to pick a lab until I actually arrived at campus and didn't actually have to formally choose a lab until the end of my first year. And while I'm definitely glad that I decided to go to a program that does rotations, as opposed to a program that you join a lab as soon as you arrive on campus, the first thing that I wish I knew before I started my PhD is that doing undergrad research isn't that much like working on your PhD research. I worked in a lab for about 3.5 years as an undergrad. I also worked in a lab for about 6 months in high school. I did an internship in pharma. I did a summer research program at Stanford. And I think that when you're doing undergrad research, which is definitely valuable, I highly recommend doing it if you're interested in going to grad school, because if you don't like it as an undergrad, then you probably don't want to do a PhD. But I definitely didn't realize how much more consuming it would be. And I don't necessarily mean that in the time sense, although that's definitely true. But as an undergrad, doing research was one small-ish part of what I did on campus. It wasn't necessarily the thing that I thought about all the time every day. And while I did definitely have ownership over the project that I worked on, we were able to publish 2 papers based on my work, it wasn't the same level of ownership, especially over an entire project that spans a lot of different domains, as my work is now. And I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. I think that it still gave me a lot of the skills that I needed to be able to be a PhD student in my program. But at the same time, I think that people are often told that doing a ton of undergrad research will be just like doing your PhD research, and I definitely didn't find that to be true, and that adjustment was a little bit challenging. Kind of along that line, the second thing that I wish that I knew was that, at least for me, the mentors that you have in your PhD are more important than the specifics of the project that you're doing. In my experience, a lot of the people who come through my program and a lot of the people who come through places like MIT are interested in working with famous PIs or on groundbreaking projects that will revolutionize the world. I think we all come in with these huge and awesome ideas about what we're going to do here. And in particular, a lot of people come in focused on a particular disease model or a particular problem in science that they're interested in tackling. And I think that's great. I didn't come into my PhD with that. I came in interested broadly in electrical engineering and computer science for medicine, but didn't really have more specific disease models or subfields that I was interested in working with. And I think that that actually helped me in finding a lab situation that really works for me. I'm co-advised. My advisors have mentorship approaches that I think mesh really well with each other, and then that meshes well with me. And at the end of the day, the project that I work on isn't actually the thing that I necessarily imagined myself working on when I came in to do my PhD. It's something that I definitely enjoy. It's also evolved significantly over the last 2 years of me being in these labs. And so I think that, at least for me, it was a lot more important to choose a lab culture that I could work in and mentors that I could work really well with and who I knew would support me in the ways that I need to be supported than to choose a particular project or a particular disease model or anything like that. And in my opinion, I think it's a better approach because you're not always going to enjoy what you work on. Even if you come in and you end up working on a project that is everything that you dreamed of working on for your PhD, it's going to get hard. And I think having those support systems, whether it be your lab, whether it be your advisors, will make the process a lot less difficult than if you came in and you joined a lab purely based on the project and then you hit those rough times that everyone hits. There's maybe an XKCD or something comment that has like the pit of despair in your third year, which I'm a third year, can confirm. And so I think that having a supportive advisor and a supportive lab, and also like friends outside of lab, and ideally support structures that are not tied to grad school, is really important, because I think that's the thing, at least for me, that gets you through grad school. It's not necessarily the project itself. On top of that, science can be somewhat unpredictable. Chances are the project that you come in planning to do isn't what you're going to defend as your thesis. So even if you come in and you're working on the thing that you always wanted to work on, that might not be what you end up working on for the entire 4 years. And if you don't also like the lab and the people that you're working with, then it's not going to be a very fun 4 years. So the third thing that I wish that I knew, and I think I kind of knew this, but I didn't really realize it until I started my PhD, is that cities are really expensive and grad students don't get paid a lot. And this may seem like a fairly obvious statement. If you didn't know, if you're doing a PhD in a STEM field in the US, you typically get paid a stipend that's designed to cover your living expenses, food, housing, etc. And as someone who goes to a school that's in a fairly expensive city, it's definitely expensive to live here. Luckily my program does actually pay us more than the average PhD program pays grad students. I think my program within MIT is one of the highest paid programs, and then MIT is one of the highest paid schools for PhDs in STEM. But I think having an idea of how the finances are going to work out is kind of important coming in. You may not know off the bat, but in particular, grad schools don't typically do things like relocation. Your stipend doesn't necessarily start until a month or so into the term. So if you're moving in August, you won't actually get paid until like mid to late September. And chances are you need to pay rent before that. You need to buy groceries before that. There's a bunch of expenses. You need to move. You need to buy furniture if you're moving into a new place and you don't have any. So I think that knowing that going in, I would have managed my money a little bit different coming into grad school. And then on top of that, when you're thinking about living in a city or in a town, wherever you are, for the next 5 to 6 years, keeping in mind that, you know, our stipends often don't have tax withholding depending on how your school does money. A lot of schools don't actually give tax advice or anything like that anyway, so you might have to figure that out on your own. Our taxes are particularly complicated for people who basically make no money. So I definitely wish I'd paid more attention to personal finance coming in and paid more attention to the rental market and what I could essentially expect as someone who had an interest in living alone but didn't realize that studio apartments can go for like $3,000 around here. So having all that kind of stuff in mind, getting a sense of the market, talking to current students if you can before you start the program to get a sense of whether or not there are going to be any unexpected financial issues, I would just highly recommend poking around at that and seeing whether or not grad school even makes sense financially for you, and then what things you should be factoring in as you start. Lastly, the thing that I wish I knew before I started my PhD, and this is something that I think would also be true for undergrad, I think it would be true for high school in general, I think it's something that I wish I did more of growing up and going through education, is just asking more questions. In spite of the fact that I do social media and have now two YouTube channels and post myself on the internet all the time, I'm actually a fairly reserved person. And I think that because of that, I often felt uncomfortable asking questions in lectures or going up to professors or teachers after class because I was confused about something. And in particular, when it comes to doing research, it's really important to ask questions, not only to help your understanding of a topic, but also because I think a lot of really interesting research ideas come out of asking questions and discovering that there isn't necessarily an answer. Especially if you can ask questions and then find people who are interested in talking to you about that, whether that be your advisor, whether that be a department journal club, whether that be just your friends who generally understand the work that you're doing. I think I've had a lot of really interesting discussions that have fueled a lot of unexpected research ideas that might not have come up otherwise, just by asking more questions and not feeling as awkward and shy about asking questions that I think might sound dumb or like I don't know what I'm talking about, because honestly, a lot of the time I don't, and I'd rather ask the question than attempt to speak on a topic that I don't know anything about. In fact, a lot of the bonus content that I make for my Nebula Plus videos is a result of me asking a lot of questions when I'm reading papers and wanting to talk to people about what I've found. If you're new to my channel, Nebula is a creator-built platform where you get to watch my videos ad-free, and some of your favorite creators, including myself, can create and experiment with awesome content without having to worry about demonetization or paying tribute to the YouTube algorithm. We're thrilled to be partnering with CuriosityStream, a subscription streaming service with thousands of documentaries and nonfiction video. Want to learn more about other awesome women in STEM? Check out Mission Unstoppable with Miranda Cosgrove, which features scientists ranging from roboticists to marine biologists to biomedical engineers. And where CuriosityStream is all about big-budget nonfiction documentaries, we're building Nebula so that education creators have a place to try out content that might not work so well on YouTube. On Nebula, you'll find ad-free videos from some of your favorite creators, from Marques Brownlee to The Coding Train to Tierzoo, as well as my Nebula Plus content, which includes extended versions of the videos you see on my channel. You'll also find Nebula originals like Tom Scott's Game Show Money or A Very Good Trivia Show, where I won $500 for drawing a really nice circle. CuriosityStream loves independent creators and wants to help us grow our platform, so if you click on the link in the description or use my promo code Jordan, you can access CuriosityStream for 26% off their annual plans, with Nebula included for free for as long as you're a CuriosityStream member. That's less than $15 a year. Signing up for CuriosityStream and Nebula is a great way to directly support my channel while getting to watch my videos ad-free and getting access to the Nebula Plus extended versions of my videos. So sign up for CuriosityStream and Nebula at curiositystream.com/Jordan or using the promo code Jordan. Otherwise, if you like this video, let me know by smashing the like button and subscribing to my channel. If you want to see more grad school content, also leave a comment, because I'm curious as to whether or not that's something that you guys want to hear a little bit more about. You can check out this video that I did on how I organize and manage my time in grad school as someone who does her PhD during the day and does content creation on the side, if you're curious about that. Otherwise, you can follow my grad life on the vlog channel, on Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok, and I will see you on Monday. Bye.